Okay, welcome everyone to this webinar on the use of computational fluid dynamics tool Flow3D for modeling dams, spillways, and related hydraulic controls. We have a truly record audience today, and I am pleased that so many professionals and also students from all over the world are interested in the work that we do here at Flow Science in New Mexico's high desert. I will leave this up for a second and show this slide again at the end of my presentation. My name is John Wendelboe. I am a CFD engineer. Any questions, please email me. Don't hesitate at all. Also, you will be able to download the recording of this presentation and the slides that go with it as soon as they are uploaded to the server after I end this talk, so sometime this afternoon, most likely. Okay, so what we will do today is focus on modeling three-dimensional flows in and around control structures. And we're also going to try to model these flows in a way that captures, as best we can, their full environmental complexity. This means looking at the quote-unquote how-to, which includes some important verification and validation topics. And what I also did was to include a good number of examples, which collectively should convey a good sense of not only how, but in what situations Flow3D is used most effectively. And additionally, I know a good number of you will be interested in seeing the detail of the nuts and bolts of how to set up a spillway, for instance, simulation in a model in Flow3D. So with this in mind, I recorded a step-by-step tutorial of me setting up and running a spillway example in Flow3D. I don't have time to go through this, the steps today, so instead I recorded the video, and if you're interested, it is part of the materials you will be able to download a little later today from this web address, flow3d.com/dams. All right, so I know some of you already know where Flow3D operates, but I still need to go over this once briefly for those who don't in the audience. And number one, Flow3D is a general purpose CFD solver. Of course, we pay a lot of attention to water and environmental flows, but we are nonetheless at the core a generally a fully nonlinear 3D Navier-Stokes solver. In addition, we treat free surfaces with a sophisticated version of the volume of fluid method, a method we actually invented back in the late 70s, called TrueVOF. Okay, and almost by definition, I can point out that we live in the realm of transients, although we capture steady states, of course, if that's the nature of the flow in question, but we are a transient solver for the most part. Also, we use a very simple but extremely effective fixed Cartesian mesh method to compute the fluid properties and also to represent solid objects. It's called the favor method. If you may have heard it, it's called the fractional area volume object representation method. And so that's how we go about representing objects by keeping a fixed Cartesian mesh to keep things numerically efficient. And really this kind of takes us to our core capability, which is really the very effective treatment we offer of free surface problems. And it is kind of this this approach that gives Flow3D this really good combination of speed, accuracy, simplicity, and robustness. And if you then add all these secondary models that are built on top of this core modeling philosophy, what you get is a very broad and extremely versatile modeling tool for a wide range of water and environmental applications. I'll kind of go through these a little later. You can quickly browse through here. Turbulence, of course, non-Newtonian fluids, granular flows and slurries, air entrainment, heat transfer, general moving objects, And so sediment scour is a big one, and also shallow water modeling for flood, a large scale flood situation. So there's just a lot there that's built on the kind of core model that we have for treating free surfaces. This is an example of what the volume of fluid method yields in terms of representation of the flow. This is an example. So in this case, we are looking at the confluence of the discharge of two ducts into a channel. And you can see, for instance, the kind of low frequency flapping back and forth that is observed. These are, of course, transient processes. And here's the classic spillway example. You can see the detail of the cross waves are captured. And of course, we can also readily measure the discharge for a given upstream elevation, for instance. So if you see here, we start with the transient and then reach a steady state after just a few seconds. Okay, so when we think about flow in and around hydraulic structures, naturally, we will first consider the structure at hand. This could be a spillway, for instance, or any number of things. It could be also a system of structures. But then we very quickly also find ourselves having to think about what processes are important. Maybe it is just the straight hydraulics, but it could also include additional elements, so air entrainment or scour or cavitation, those sorts of things. And the next questions are then, well, what can be done given these interests? And maybe crucially, how is this information actionable? So these are the kind of way we'll be thinking about things today. And so the user's experience and methods will answer a lot of these questions. But in the end, the broad workflow is always the same. By and large, the first step is to create a numerical description of the environment we are modeling. This step actually has nothing to do with computational fluid dynamics. The first step is about creating a 3D CAD version of your built environment. It's not CFD, it's mostly CAD, or maybe ArcGIS, or something equivalent type of work. And this needs to happen before you even open Flow3D. So I want to be clear about that. After that, you need to know something about your environmental conditions in the field. And it's only at that point that you will begin your CFD work in earnest, which hopefully delivers a CFD analysis. And then depending on how thorough your validation and verification procedures are, this will yield varying levels of confidence in terms of actionable insights. Okay, so let's start with CAD, so this first part. What do we need? We need a description of, typically a description of the terrain. This could come from any number of sources, in America, USGS or LIDAR, for instance. And then we also need 3D CAD of the built structures. All of this then gets imported in the STL formats into Flow3D. We import STL files. I will show you an example of what this looks like inside Flow3D shortly. In the meanwhile, as a matter of straight CAD, this is what a built environment might look like. And note, we are adding actually some new functionalities in version 11.1, which is released this fall. You'll be able to import terrain files directly without having to bother with converting those to STL at all. You'll just import them as terrain files. And you'll also be able to overlay visual maps within Flow3D. So here are some snapshots of what this will look like. You can import the terrain file and the accompanying aerial view. You will also be able to see this in the post processor. And actually, a quick note, side notes, I guess, for those who use shallow water modeling for larger scale flooding applications, you will also be able to download land coverage and surface roughness values in the same fashion. So getting back to CAD. This is what a CAD file might look like. You need to build this numerical description of your environment before you start your CFT work in earnest. There's no way around it. And we have a power station, powerhouse here, log curtain, radial gates, vertical gates, a log barrier, a channel. So these are the bridge. So these are the things you need to kind of build in CAD before you start your CFT modeling. In practice, friends, we have this case from our friends up north in Canada at Tetra Tech. And what we have here is a dam. This is kind of a skirt dam and then a powerhouse and some bathymetry. And so this gets represented as in a CAD format before you start your simulation. And we've added some water as well. Just an example of what this looks like and a few more examples. Just to reiterate the correspondence between the real environments, the built environments, and the numerical environments. If you take the time to do this step well, it really gives you a very good foundation from which to execute the CFD portion of the work. So, you know, you can see the correspondence here, you can see the fish passage geometry, spillway geometry, and so on. Oh, it's one last example here. An arch dam overtopping analysis, courtesy, I forget who actually, I apologize. And so again, you have to build your environments before doing your CFD. So take home message number one, the CAD portion is essential preparation work for successful 3D CFD projects. No way around it. Now in Flow3D, the good news is that once you have your STL files that build your environments, setting up the model in Flow3D is actually quite trivial. You really just import STL files and overlay a fixed mesh over that geometry. More on these steps in the accompanying video tutorial I mentioned earlier on, which you can download. You'll be able to download a little bit later this afternoon. And when you favorize the geometry, this is showing you what the solver actually sees. I also explain more of this in the tutorial. But the essential idea is that your solid object simply kind of floats, so to speak, in a fixed mesh. There's no boundary fitting involved. Now, we do have conformal meshing, but that's different from boundary fitted meshes. We stick with Cartesian meshing approaches. And kind of, if you look at the detail, what really happens with the favor method is that the geometry is more or less linearly approximated within each computational cell. So there's a little bit of geometric resolution loss, normally not significant. However, the trade-off for this, again, usually very minor loss of geometric detail, the trade-off is this really unparalleled combination I have already mentioned of speed, accuracy, robustness, and simplicity. In almost all cases for water and environmental applications, the favor method is really an excellent choice in terms of overall performance. Okay, so summarizing here a little, these are important aspects to understand about Flow3D. They are the four aspects I just mentioned. So speed, simplicity, accuracy, robustness. And those really come from the kind of modeling philosophy, the core philosophy we have about how we go about modeling free surfaces and objects within fixed grids. The versatility comes from something else. The versatility comes from the physical models. You could call them secondary models or auxiliary models. These are the models that are built on top of our core solver, and they just kind of plug in. They don't plug in; that you just activate them as you decide to. So we have kind of went through this already: turbulence, K omega, K epsilon, RNG, large eddy simulation. Quite a few good choices there. Air entrainment and bulking is really a strong model for tailings. Occasionally, you will be looking at non-Newtonian behaviors, shear thinning, typically, for bubbles. And so that's for mining, more like mining applications. And then goes on, cavitation is used in the context of dams, obviously. Buoyant flows, thermal plumes, effluents, environmentally sensitive and important models. And occasionally, actually, I like this one a lot, the granular flow model. This is for shear thickening. mechanisms, which also can happen in tailing and mining operations. So few things here, and we'll see how this plays out in throughout the presentation. Okay. Environmental conditions. We are still not doing CFD just yet. Determination of physics and flow environmental conditions. So, you have to try and understand what's happening in the real world and apply those kind of forcing mechanisms into your model. And it's actually quite simple if you have data to work with. So mostly the user needs to make a determination of initial and boundary conditions. And again, just well, talking about the next release, we have some really interesting new boundary conditions that have been added for the river folks. So where we now, in fact, have rating curves as well as fully developed inlet boundary conditions. I'm not actually going to talk about this now, but it's a really interesting work, and that's I will give a presentation on this at some point, I'm guessing in September. Some really nice things for the river modelers. And I thought this was quite interesting, actually very interesting, because the physics you include are in a sense part of what is forcing the fluid. In this example, we are running a stilling basin analysis with and without air entrainments and the subsequent bulking that comes with that air entrainment. So it's very interesting to look at the effects of the air entrainment and the bubbles' buoyancy and drag on the flow itself. So we have the fluid coming in this way, doing its hydraulic jump thing with some the velocity, anything that's not red is kind of recirculating. Anything that's red is going streamwise. So you have a recirculation region here and, of course, up here where you expect it. If you look at the, this is without air entrainment. If you look at the air entrainment, you see mostly this is where it's happening. There's a lot of entrainment here, and then through just buoyancy, the bubbles leave this, retract to the surface and escape, and some of them recirculate. Now, this has an effect on the flow itself, not major, but it does have an effect. And if you look at these, I'll pause this in a second once we get a little bit further, but the flow field that actually itself is different as a result of the effect. You can see here the velocity vectors with air entrainment and the velocity vectors without air entrainment. Interesting. Okay, so examples. I said I would show you some examples. So I have a, I don't know, maybe a half dozen or so. I've got labyrinth spillways, morning glories, off-design spillway geometries, and so on. Yes. Okay. So CFD analysis, basically. Labyrinth weirs, spillways. So we have fluid rising here in the basin, and going over the labyrinth weir, and then going down the spillway. And what we are interested in seeing is what happens for a given elevation upstream. So there's a few things you can look at. One is the discharge in and of itself, what's going through the spillway. You can look at the flooding that is appearing. I'm going to pause this in a second. Okay, so let's see what we have. Up here, we have the detail of the upper portion of the spillway, just the fluid. You can see some of the cross waves. And here we have the lower portion. And you can see that there's some overtopping here happening as the kind of super elevated side of the flow reaches over the side of the embankment. And in this picture down here, you have a visualization of what's called the maximum flood depth. So any water this is the maximum flood over the entire episode. So we have some flooding happening here, a little bit there. And this view is a kind of an X-ray view from space, where the black is showing you the confluence of waves. So you can see the cross waves patterns quite nicely. Okay. Another example, a morning glory example. So you can see here, this is a still shot. You can see sometimes under certain conditions, and this topography, bathymetry is very asymmetric, and this is why the vortex is being so quickly generated here. So, but these are free surface problems that can be modeled very nicely with the volume of fluid method. If you look here, you will see the flow chokes at some point, and then we get this kind of intermittent air entrapment that's occurring during this kind of transient towards more. At some point, if the flow continued to be elevated, this would kind of taper off. You still have vorticity, but not the same kind of core. Okay. River hydraulic control system. So in this case, we are showing a few different dynamics, but the key interest is really the sediment scour. So I mentioned the hydraulics. One aspect as well, we have these gates here, vertical gates and some radial gates, which in this case are closed. We have this power station. And so, yes, we can look at the flow rates, although plenty of monographs out there, which will give us pretty precise answers as is, so no need really for 3D CFD for those cases. But we're still interested in the subsequent velocity field and the shear stresses on the riverbed, and that's where 3D CFD comes into play and is quite handy. And then we can look, based on these shear stresses, we can look at the sediment scour, and then the re-entrainment, deposition, transport, and look at what's happening downstream here on these around the bridge piers. Okay. And I just said that usually you could use monographs to figure out most of these situations. Well, occasionally the downstream flow will actually interfere with the operation of the gates, if the kind of flooded condition downstream or semi-flooded. So in these cases, you can actually use CFD, 3D CFD, quite nicely to figure out the detail of how this is impacting the flow rates through these gates. And cavitation. So what I showed you before was a morning glory spillway. Just we had the kind of air entrainments. Cavitation is a different process. We have just low pressures, and this is from a dam in Italy. I forget the name, but it's based on a hydrologic a lab study, and what they found was the cavitation happening right here, actually. It's quite interesting, and that's what we are seeing as well, in fact, with this analysis. Exactly the same location of where the cavitation is happening. The other thing we see with these types of simulation, I'll pause this for a second, you see, what's going on here is that we have the free surface elevation up here, which is just being ramped up from its normal level to its kind of maximum average mean level as per the hydrograph. So initially, we have a condition up here of a weir, just like a free flow across the weir. Then we have a transition. So in this case, as the elevation goes up, the discharge increases, and then we have some messy transients here. And then after that, we get into a condition where, in fact, the flow rate is no longer controlled by the top here, but rather by the orifice equation down here. So you see this transition quite nicely, and then it doesn't matter how much you increase the pressure upstream, you're only getting a marginal improvement in the discharge. So these are things you can see very nicely and with good accuracy using CFD methods. Okay. Courtesy of friends at Ganner Fleming, who do a lot of this type of work. The curved spillways, these are, you know, these, the land is built and we have less room to make things work. And so we have often situations where we can't really use, there's no kind of experimental data that's already been done for a similar scenario. So we have to improvise a little bit. And CFD allows us to look at things quite nicely ahead of time. It's not that it's replacing a physical model necessarily, but it really can give you some insights before you build your models, which can be quite expensive. So that's an example. Again, the flood. This is showing the flooded areas for a given elevation upstream. Okay, and this is a detail of the spillway geometry. What also happens, again, courtesy of Ben at Gannon Fleming, are these situations where you have a spillway and time goes by, and either the hydrograph has been updated since 50 years ago, or we're adding something. So in this case, we're adding a bridge pier here, and the question is, given a new hydrograph and given this bridge pier. Here, how is this modifying the crosswave? So you can look at the detail here, the 2D cut of the crosswave. You can look at the crosswave from above, and you can see if or not the worry was, is this going to overtop actually at this point rather than down here? So you can look at all those things quite nicely with tools like Flow 3D. And then this one from, I think I already mentioned, from our friends up in Canada. This, I'll pause it before it starts. We have a, what happened is there was a rapid power a shutdown of the turbines. And this created a wave which propagated upstream and did some damage. And normally you could tackle this with shallow water models, not a problem. Except that this skirt dam here actually creates a point where the flow is actually pressurized in a non-free surface manner. It's pressurized because this is actually extending down under the elevation of the river locally. So in those cases, you're really better off using a 3D solution. And so these are three probes, and these are free surface elevations. And you can see here, the flow rate at the powerhouse is going to go from 140 and go to zero in about 15 seconds. So, and that's going to create a wave, which you can see now propagating upstream, a wave of about 70 centimeters, so about 2 feet. This is roughly what was, actually, this is quite accurately what was observed when this happened. Okay, so the wave propagating. So I saw some really interesting presentation last year at ASDSO by USBR, and apparently there's this problem with type 2 stilling basins where there's recirculation patterns are actually dragging clutter back into the sill, and this creates a lot of abrasion damage. It's a big problem, and they've studied this for a while now and done physical experiments, and these things are big. USB 2 dam, these are big structures. So they did some tests and everything, identified that you have average flow leaving, localized flow returning, and this I thought was really interesting, all the air entrainment that you see, it kind of goes down and then goes up again because of buoyancy. So they did all that work, and I left the conference thinking, I wonder if Flow 3D can model this. So I took one of my old type 2 basins and I kind of looked at the analysis in a bit more detail. And so this is a 3D simulation, but it's a 2D slice through a 3D simulation. So this kind of intermediate region here is kind of going in and out of the plane, but there is recirculation that's observed here. And in fact, in a 2D solution, it's a little bit cleaner. You can see anything that's blue is, or not red rather, is recirculating. So we have, this is what we know, and this is what's also what maybe we didn't entirely suspect right when these things were designed. So you can see that through this type of modeling, and this is a type 4, so really just different size, different approach, Froude number, but you can see how you develop the hydraulic jump and all those recirculation regions. All right. So closely related are energy dissipation structures. This one is, and what we look at here, you have to look at your turbulence modeling quite carefully. But what we're doing here is that basically creating structures where turbulence is going to dissipate energy. And so what we are interested in knowing is we have so much energy in the flow up here, and what's left down here, how effective has this structure been? So often we look at total hydraulic head. That's one way of doing it. And by the way, there's a really good note on this on the website. Take a look. So that's one way of looking at it, the total hydraulic head. Maybe more sophisticated is actually to look at the hydraulic energy flux. So you take a measuring plane, a flux plane upstream, a flux plane downstream, and you look at the total flux of hydraulic energy across these planes. And so by looking at those quantities, this is what's incoming, this is what's leaving. The difference here is really the best measurement for to gauge how effectively we are dissipating energy through the device. Okay, we've reached steady state more or less. You see the flow comes in, kind of bounces through these. Let me go back to the beginning where you can see. Okay, the cylindrical kind of baffles in here. These are kind of obstructions, and the flow can go through, but it kind of bounces in and out of these circular baffles, which have holes in the middle. Okay, you can see that. And then finally, it reaches its steady state. Of course, if you have too much resistance, the flow is going to back up. Not good. So there's a fine balance there. All right. Similar thing here, apron. You can see where the turbulent dissipation is happening. But overall, with all of this dissipation that's happening, what you see here again is the energy loss across the so this is the yellow is coming in, the green is leaving. Okay, so time, effort, and considerations. A lot of in my experience, a lot of work goes actually into this CAD preparation, obtaining field data step that I mentioned earlier on. You know, first of all, getting access to field data is quite difficult if you have to do it from scratch. Bathymetry can be old. You know, sediment accumulation, morphological changes, etc. And then getting new field data is difficult. And above ground data is quite a lot easier. So you can get LIDAR and USGS and all those things. And then the build structures, it's okay actually to simplify things very generally. You don't have to model every single detail in order to get what you need out of a build of a CAD 3D structure. But nonetheless, a lot of work goes into all these steps in creating the kind of fundamental model. But once the environment is known in a CAD format, the CFD portion is quite is okay. It's not so difficult and it's not so time consuming. It's really a fraction of the project timeline. Then we have computer hours, and I cannot say how hugely dependent this is on meshing choices. I'll get back to that in a second, but we're talking orders of magnitude. The hardware available is important too. It's true that a machine that goes two times faster than another machine will accelerate things. And then the modeling assumptions and the choices you make for your models and how much physics you pack into your model, what's essential or less essential, those are choices that have real consequences for your computer hours. And then, of course, the software and modeling platform that is being used. So Flow3D is extremely efficient, maybe the fastest code possibly for 3D modeling. But nonetheless, it's still, you know, the software has its own limits in how they do things. Now, this means that you need to be extremely clear with the modeler, you know, what are you looking for? You have to know what you're looking for, what not to bother with. And I've seen this a lot. It's easy to overmodel. And the cost of overmodeling is very high in computational time. And then what's nice these days is that you have, I'm kind of in this section here, the access to high performance computing resources. And those are actually in the scheme of a budget with all these man hours and all these things, a very small fraction of a CFD modeling budget. You can get high performance computing on the cloud. And it's getting cheaper and cheaper. So in other words, use it. We have a cluster in house, and it's just amazing how nice it is to have things be accelerated by a factor of 5 or 10 or even more sometimes compared to my desktop machine. So being clear about what the modeler is looking for is entirely critical. And it's also really an easy mistake to overmodel. And then if you have access to high performance computing, and it's there, it's on the cloud, use it. It's really very advantageous. So just a quick slide on the topic of high performance computing. It, you know, just to show you the metric, the kind of improvements in speed, this stuff really works. You scale up, or we have a cluster version of Flow3D called Flow3D MP, which is what you would use if you wanted to on the cloud or on your own cluster. But the gains are really significant. You know, if you're going from just say 6 cores on my desktop machine to 128 cores on our cluster, for me, that's usually for hydraulic problems, an improvement of 10 in speed. So 10 days becomes 1 day. That's what you get roughly in my case. Okay, so very important section here. Verification and validation procedures. We have over 100 years of experimental data available, which is just a treasure trove of hydraulic data that's available from the Army Corps, USBR, FERC, hydraulic labs, academia. And so with experience, modelers do begin to know where they stand with respect to their models in relation to published data. But for serious long-term use, a process of systematic comparison between lab data and field data can and should be documented. Every project you make, you have to document something about your validations and your verification procedures. Over time, this builds up into increasing the level of certainty that you have in your results, which translates into higher confidence enough to give you actionable intelligence, so to speak, that you can trust. So, and also, what are you looking for? Flow rates are actually, you can get a very precise solution for flow rates with amazingly coarse resolution. Very often. For pressure, you need to have a higher resolution. For energy losses, you have to have a lot of real good understanding of your turbulence models and how they relate to your mesh size and those sorts of things. So different metrics have different sensitivities, both physical and numerical, and you know, it's a process of learning what's what. And what are you after also? Are you looking at the broad flow patterns? Are you looking at absolute accuracy or relative design performance? That also shapes the way you do things. So just an example, very common. We have the Army Corps. You've all seen this. Curves, discharge for head discharge and all those things. So you can take something like this, you can take a look and you can plot it and let's see. We model this and then with a very coarse mesh, 8% error depending on the total head on the crest, 7%. Okay, well, it's not the end of the world because this is really stuff that runs very quickly. And this is for a coarse mesh. So you'll wonder, if I refine my mesh, what happens? So the coarse mesh here is in blue. Okay, where we have this kind of percentage, we're a little bit off. And then with a, if you refine the mesh a little bit smaller, in yellow, we are awfully close to our kind of design line, which we think is probably the truth of where the flow, how the flow is behaving. And if you refine it even more, in fact, you don't see the red ones because they're under the yellow ones. There's nothing to improve anymore. We've reached mesh independence. And I'll just point out that mesh independence is not the same as convergence towards an accurate solution. You can converge towards a solution based on mesh refinement. Doesn't mean that that is the correct solution. So just keep that in mind. And, for instance, you could imagine, if there was a mistake in the code, that this line could be, let's say, shifted here to the left, the black line, and you would still see this convergence, blue, yellow, red, and you would think, we've reached red, we've reached mesh convergence, but we have the wrong solution. So keep that in mind. And then it's important to know your experimental uncertainty. This is actually the original data on which this curve was based, and you see there's a good amount of noise. So in this case, it turns out that Flow3D is actually within experimental noise. For these types of analyses. So you can't really get, you're getting close to this line, but in reality, this is the truth depending on different situations and whatever. So that's also something to keep in mind. And, just people, I spoke about academia, people, researchers do tests and they measure, for instance, pressure on a spillway, and then they do a CFD. So there's a USACE Army Corps data, USBR data, CFD data, which is Flow3D in this case, and you plot your results, and so you can gain some confidence towards the operation of your tools using these kinds of verifications. So best practice, a good mesh is by far the most important single item that determines the quality of a CFD simulation. It has a disproportionate effect on accuracy, on runtimes, on file size, and on the actual performance of specific types of schemes or models. Then always, always, always start simple and then add complexity, and then test for mesh dependencies. And then number four, ground results with other sources of data. It can be previous experiments. It can be other numerical models, not other methods, numerical methods, other software. It can be back of the envelope calculations. It can be an array of different sources of validation data. It's not always just the lab, the physical lab data. There's other ways of verifying things as well. And this is an interesting chart that some of our users kind of follow. What's interesting here is that your simulation, the one that's, the case at hand, begins here. This has nothing to do with, really not much to do with what you are trying to simulate. The real case you have begins here. But before really doing your case, these are the important steps that you need to do. First, you start with a simplified model. And then you look, does it run? Are the results reasonable? Kind of fix mistakes. And then you'll start testing numerical methods. And then you'll calibrate knobs, boundaries, things like the boundaries. Are they affecting the solution by being too close, inlet turbulence, surface roughness, all sorts of parameters that can be calibrated. And you want to understand these sensitivities. Then you also want to do some mesh refinement, and you want to compare this to known CFD results. But this is all done for a simplified case, but which is representative of your complicated case. So you want to do all your difficult kind of testing work on a case that's fairly generic, which you'll then be able to recycle each time you have a complicated case which is of this nature, that fits into this set of validation and verification procedures. Each time in the future you have something that fits into this category, you don't have to redo the whole thing. You already have an awful lot of documentation there handy to look and compare with. So you do this and you ask yourself, is it all good? Are the parameters understood, sensitivity understood? And what you need to do is to log these into a long-term quality control library for future reference. This is really the key step, so that you're not reinventing the wheel every time. You're building confidence, and you can show people, look, these are all the things we've done over and over again. Now we've built a level of confidence that's sufficient that we can go ahead and model this specific simulation without redoing the whole thing. So I quite like this workflow, but it's really with the view of a long-term use of CFD modeling. So for reference, really, types of uncertainty, numerical inputs, let's start with numerical. Rounding errors, that's usually not a problem so much. Convergence, iteration errors, not. It does relate to mesh quality, but in Flow3D, it's really not. It's rare. The pressure convergence is something that we control well and is very robust. So numerical uncertainties for us is not really a big one. Input uncertainty can be geometry. You just don't know what you have. Well, that really throws a wrench into the detail. The confidence you have in your solution. Initial conditions will usually kind of work their way through the system. Parameter uncertainty is a big one. When you parameterize models, whatever you do with the parametric model, there is a question: are you using the right parameter? So this also comes with this verification and validation effort I just mentioned. And then model uncertainty. This is actually quite interesting. Comparison uncertainty, physical scale model. Yeah, that's a problem, and it's specifically for air entrainments, where there are real difficulties in scaling both the fluid behaviors and the air bubble behaviors. So sometimes this is very tricky. Turbulence, of course, is difficult in all situations. Okay, so beyond the hydraulics, so I mentioned air entrainment. This is actually coming from municipal hydraulics work I did a while back. And what you're seeing here is this. There's a flume here. Water's coming in, goes down in this tank. There's a piping system, and then there's a weir, a tank, and a weir, and it overflows on the other side. And this is going up and down. And this is what the reason we did this work is because they built the structure, and they saw they had their flume going through. The water would go in there, and then rise in the tank, and actually rise so much it would backflow into the flume, making it completely inoperable. So, and the reason was air entrainment. And so we have air entrainment in this model, and what we see is exactly this process of bulking. The air gets entrained, gets released, and so on. The static pressure changes and so on. So this was very nice because we modeled, we reproduced without any without any effort. We just use our standard code, standard air entrainment, and reproduced the exact frequency that was observed in the field. So that was really nice. So that's air entrainment. Plumes and river discharges. This is courtesy of Navid Nikwe at Tetra Tech. We did this work with him a little while back as well. And this is Lake Michigan, a ton of field data to observe. And you have an effluent and a discharge. And then you have the flow 3D model here. And you'll see that after a while, it really overlaps quite nicely with what was observed in the field based on all the, and you know, we set up the model based on the conditions, the parameters that we saw, density of the fluid coming in, etc. What you can note here, when you look at this from space, you're actually seeing the integrated version of the kind of transparency of the water column. In reality, you do see these kind of spires because there's this interesting vertical mixing process that happens with these types of effluents, but over time they kind of mix and mix over the depth of the fluid, and what you see is this integrated version of the sediments. Quite interesting. And here's an example. In this case, slightly different conditions, different wind conditions, different sediment load, etc. And so you see, you know, we model this, and you have something that's, if you look at the outside, the envelope of this plume, it looks an awful lot like what was observed in the field. So encouraging work there, I thought. Then sediment scour, that's really a big strength for us. Entrainment, deposition, scour, and then kind of resettling of sediment downstream, all good stuff. And this one is kind of generic, but it's interesting because you'll see the accumulation. This is just basically sediment-laden water being dumped into a pond. And what you'll see quite soon is the accumulation of sediment right here. This is the accumulation of sediment in this corner. And in time, of course, the sediment itself begins to affect the hydraulics of the flow and change the hydraulic behavior. So we have the accumulation here that's happening in this corner. You can see it there. And this in turn kind of feeds back into the hydraulics. So quite interesting there. Okay, and then just one last, I think it's the last example I have of sediment scour. This is a stilling basin, and you can see the patterns here, sediment change for this case. Okay, so beyond, you know, just a few examples of what I call beyond the hydraulics, but in fact, you have all these models here in Flow 3D, quite a lot to choose from. If you download the tutorials I recorded, you can take a look. I do show you in more detail what these things do. Okay, so conclusions. CFD methods offer definitely a broad range of engineering insights. It's not all, you can have absolute data insights, you can have comparative type data, and you can use the tool in a prognostic way or a diagnostic or forensic way. You can do that, all those things in different ways. And in many respects, that's my view at least, is that working in 3D is actually much simpler than working in approximate 1D or 2D environments. There are fewer assumptions, fewer uncertainties. The view of the environment is much clearer, and the understanding of the flow is also much clearer. So I find 3D actually simpler than 1D and 2D. And then there's a lot of models you can build upon beyond the core hydraulics, you know, phase change, cavitation, biochemistry, contaminant transport, sediment, etc., and even fully resolved kind of large scale bubbles, something we see in municipal flows quite often. Aha, afterthoughts. I thought of this morning. I'm talking about all these, you know, these dams and these hydraulics. I didn't say a word about dam break modeling. So real quick, you can do 3D. You can do shallow water, very efficient, 99%. That is the method to use. And then you can use hybrid 3D shallow water modeling. So you can get the 3D detail near a dam breach event or near a critical infrastructure. But for everywhere else where you don't need 3D, you can use shallow water modeling. So I have an example here, which was the St. Francis dam break flood in California back in the, I think, 1928, about 80 kilometer from the dam site to the Pacific Ocean. So this is how kind of time zero, we have the reservoir and then the detail of the topography. And the dam is this small thing, right? It's huge, but it's tiny on this picture. And then you have, this is, let's see. So this is a shallow water model. So we just, this is the total flood, so maximum flood depth. And then we see some, you know, good, this is the actual Santa Paula Bridge is about two thirds down the way. So this is the arrival time somewhere there. I think it's right here. So there's a good distance has been covered already. And you see with the coarse mesh, 60 meter cells, we're getting there a bit, let's see, too slowly and not with enough wave height, the impact. So dissipating too much energy on the way. 30 meter cells, we're awfully close to the real time at which this dam event, I mean, the wave actually arrived in Santa Paula. And we know this time because something happened. So maybe the electric got turned off or something. And then with the 15 meter cell, well, we are a little bit, we're kind of converging, you can tell, on the wave height, but we're definitely converging on the time of arrival. Okay, and now, so this is a kind of approximate reconstruction. This is a map that was made, you know, 1928, I suppose. So the flooded area as measured at the time, and then what was came out of this particular analysis with all the many, many uncertainties that went into that model. So this is the hybrid model. So we have a 3D solution here near the top. Let me play this again. Let me go back. So 3D, in what happened in real life is the central part of the dam actually stayed up. So we have the central part of the dam and then the walls on the side gave. And we said, we have 3D solution. You'll see the embankments happening here. There's up and down and left. And then at some point here, we're going to transition to a shallow water solution when it changes. Okay, right here. So this from here on is a shallow water solution. And this is the instantaneous flood wave. That's why the fluid is disappearing upstream. Okay, makes its way down and etc. Okay, and in this case, we get a slightly different answer. We get a significantly higher flood wave about the same time of arrival, a bit faster. And I thought this was interesting because I need to look into this some more, but, you know, capturing the detail of the dam break when it's in a catastrophic mode really is a 3D process. It's not a shallow water process. And I've done some work with actually tsunami wave run-up where you really see the difference when you have strong vertical accelerations, whether up going downwards or upwards on a steep topography, for instance, you really see quite a significant difference between the wave run up using a shallow water model versus a 3D non hydrodynamic nonlinear model. So I thought this was quite interesting. Okay, so that's it now. Thank you. All questions you can send to me, john.wendelboe@flow3d.com. Thanks again for attending. And a little bit later this afternoon, check in, maybe, you know, 4 o'clock East Coast time. All these materials should be at this link, flow3d.com/dams. Thank you.